Hello, good morning, good afternoon, good evening. I'm Nadia. I'm an exam support manager at Cambridge, and I'm saying hello to everybody from Cambridge today. Welcome. Thank you so much for joining us. It will be an exciting webinar on mindfulness and well-being to help prepare our learners for Cambridge English exams. Before we start, just a little bit of housekeeping. A lot of you ask regularly about certificates. You will all get certificates. At the end of the webinar, you'll be sent an email with a link to download your certificate. So not to worry, that will come. You can also use the chat, which you're all doing already. Let us know where you're joining us from. If you want to write comments for everybody, please make sure to use the chat. If you've got a question for me or for our presenter, Andrea, please use the Q&A box for that. And right, I think we're ready to start. So Andrea, welcome to you and over to you on mindfulness.
Hello, Nadia. Thank you very much. And good morning, good afternoon, good evening from everybody. It's fantastic to see so many of you from so many different countries in the world. And I'm saying hello to you today from Barcelona in Spain. So today we're looking at mindfulness and well-being to prepare our learners for the Cambridge English exams. And in the next 40, 45 minutes or so, we're going to have a think about what is mindfulness, how can it help in exam preparation, and how can we incorporate it into our classes. So we're going to have a look at different techniques and strategies of how we can incorporate this into our exam preparation classes. But to begin with, I would like to do a word cloud with you all. So on the screen, you can see we've got a menti.com. Can you type in what words come to mind when you think of mindfulness? So let me just make sure I am on the right screen. Yes, I am. Okay. So you'll see, focus, excellent. Okay, we're gonna wait a little bit longer. So can you try and use the Mentimeter so we can see everybody's words? We've got focus, calm, to see, yes, Georgia put in into the chat box insight. So you can see you've got also the QR code here so you can access the Mentimeter as well. Mindfulness, okay, well-being, consideration. Excellent. Being present, considerations. We're going to wait a little bit more. So we've got more people adding their words. So fantastic. Health, relaxation, grounding. Okay, focus, well-being. So we have some more. See some in the chat. Yes, we've got awareness, Beatrix, as solace. More. Give it one more minute. So we've got 17, 18 people now answering. Breath. Fantastic. Being aware. So Hina says in the chat, thoughts. Okay, so we'll just give it 30 more seconds, see if some more people put what words come to mind when you think of the word mindfulness. Self-love, fantastic. Here, serenity, wonderful words. The now. Oh, Mustafa put in the chat, love, wonderful. Being aware, okay, fantastic. So these are kind of words that you think of when come to your mind when you think about when you think about the word mindfulness. Okay, so let's go back to our presentation. Okay, so according to the Cambridge Online Dictionary definition, according to that dictionary, the practice, mindfulness is the practice of being aware. So we saw these words, you thought of aware, awareness of your body, mind and feelings, being in the present moment, and thought to create a feeling of calm. But also I'd like to, mindfulness and meditation is very, very strange. Nobody thought of meditation, but more often than not, lots of people might think, okay, when they think of mindfulness, they think of meditation as well. And I really thought today it's important to differentiate between what is mindfulness and what is meditation. And here is another more in-depth definition of mindfulness. It's the simple act of paying attention, noticing, being present, being in the now, being actively mindful of our thoughts, feelings, behaviors, movements, noticing the world around you and the effects you have on others around you. And when we think about meditation, it's more of a practice where you want to increase calmness and concentration and awareness, but it's the idea from you're tuning inwards with meditation. So for today, we're really focusing on this idea of mindfulness, being in the now, being present, being aware of everything and everyone around you. So think about mindfulness. So how does mindfulness fit in with exam preparation? So when we're preparing our students for exams, of course, we need to help them. And here on the screen now, you'll see I've got 5 points that we do. We help this. We help our students in this way to prepare for our exams. So the first one, I've hidden the words. So the first sentence, what do we help them? We help them to understand the, I've given you the first letter. Exactly, Rav Shanbek, apologies if I haven't said your name properly, but yes, we help them to understand the purpose. So making sure our students know why exams are useful. So it's not just them having to pass an exam, but showing them that many of these task types that we are asking them to do are actually useful. They're going to be useful in the real life, such as answering personal questions, writing emails. Also, exams help them check their own progress and celebrate their success. So we have to also explain that they understand that the purpose of exams is much more than just passing it. Okay, yes, Nunziata, you're in there already. Number two is familiarize. So of course we need to help our learners to familiarize our learners with the exam. So this is helping them become familiar with the exam content, explaining to them in a student-friendly way the assessment criteria and how to approach the tasks. So we're really helping them to build their confidence. Number three, enable exam preparation. What could be number three? Individual? Yes, and long as there are any others, any other words? Amelia, thank you. Yes, independent. Fantastic. Vasola, apologies if I haven't pronounced your name correctly. Yes, enable independent exam preparation. So helping our students become more independent learners so they can actually continue outside of the classroom and helping them have this control over their own learning. Yes, Carla, you're right. You're already there. The right frame, there are two words here, getting them in the right frame of mind. So to feel confident, our learners need to believe in themselves. We all need to believe in ourselves in order to feel confident. And research, of course, has shown that it really does matter how well students expect to do in the exam. So triggering that right mindset is also very important. So I hope if I have explained what I meant there now about the right mindset, so that they believe in themselves, that they can do well in the exam, yeah? We'll have a look, we'll see, this is a theme that we'll also look at a little bit later on in the webinar. And the last one, number five, see clear. Yeah, Amelia, calm. Okay, calm. I'm not quite sure we can ever really clear our minds, but definitely calm their brain. So feeling nervous is absolutely normal. It's an normal emotion. It's something that we all feel. Emotions are at the center of all human behavior, and of course learning and teaching is no exception. So taking exams is a real important and key part of life, but it can be often stressful, as I think all of us have been through this process. So it's not necessarily only focusing on language knowledge, exam strategies, but also helping our learners to develop ways to manage their own well-being, to be comfortable, to be happy, to be positive, learning how to maintain this well-being and manage stress in exam preparation enables our learners to succeed. And of course, it's an invaluable life skill. So for the next step, thinking about these 5 points, we're going to be now really focusing in on points 4 and 5. So thinking about how we can help our students get into that right frame of mind and how we can help them calm their brain and deal with these completely natural emotions. So we're going to first look at introducing mindful moments in the classroom. How do we introduce mindful moments into the classroom? What kind of questions come to your mind about introducing mindful moments in the classroom? If you want to put in the chat box, what questions do you think of? Do you think, how do I introduce a mindful moment into my teenage classroom? How do you feel? Okay, thank you, Tessad. Any other questions that come to? I've got 4 questions here that I think, well, you know, okay. So where to begin? These may be some questions, well, that you think, how do I introduce it to my students? How do I introduce a mindful moment to my students? What would you like to achieve? Another question I thought about is, what do mindful moments look like in a teenage classroom? Maybe we've never seen a mindful moment. Maybe what does it really mean? What does it look like? How can I engage my students? How do I get, well, engage is what you said there. And how can I engage my students? How do I get them on board? How do I get them involved in this mindful moment? You know, they have to also understand it and believe in this. And the last question, of course, how do I have time? How do I have time with to be able to implement this mindful moment? So we're going to have a look at different steps and how can maybe we could begin to introduce these mindful moments. So first of all, develop belief. So just like any new technique or strategy that we try in our classrooms, we have to really deeply believe in it first. So it's a simple, powerful tool, but the benefits also are not only for students, they can also be for us to be more present in our classroom. So we have to deeply, you know, we have to believe ourselves as teachers in these mindful moments. And then of course, as always, creating a plan. So how can we create a plan? First of all, we could watch videos of teachers leading mindful moments. And this is where now I'm going to show you, we're going to watch together a video of a teacher introducing what she calls mindful minutes. Okay. I'm going to play this video. And as you can see now on the screen, I have sentence beginnings. Okay. So I have the beginnings of sentences and I've covered up the ends of these sentences. So what I'd like you to do when you're watching the video, we're going to give you at the end, you'll also have a great resources where you can find more resources on this as well. So when you're watching the video, I'd like you to pay attention to these 3 sentences. So the first one, mindful body, feet. Number 2, give them a chance to make it all the way into the room with their. 3, she tells us to listen to. Okay, so when you hear them in the video, try and remember what they say afterwards. And then after we've watched the video, we'll check to see if you heard the words right, okay? So just leave that for 1 minute. The three sentences: mindful body, feet. Sentence number two, give them a chance to make it all the way into the room with their. Three, she tells us to listen to. Okay, so now I'm going to press here and we'll go, and you should be able to see it now. Okay, so let's watch the video.
I don't know how they do it. They go from one class to a passing period, then back to another class with a completely different subject.
You go through the day without feeling how you feel. You just wake up, do your morning routine, go to school, come back home, and you don't stop, you know? And with mindfulness, you do stop.
Mindful body, feet are flat on the floor. Become aware of your body. So just notice your body. Mindful minute usually happens at the start of class. What I'm trying to do is give them a chance to arrive, is to give them a chance to make it all the way into the room with their bodies and their awareness. I'm gonna turn off my voice and let you breathe for a couple of minutes without my voice.
She tells us to listen to our breathing and recognize the fact that you are breathing, letting you stop for a minute, just reflect on yourself and how you feel.
When I was really stressing and worrying about stuff, when I took these mindful minutes, it's like, I'm gonna be fine. Like, I'm gonna get through this.
It's a very easy, very simple way to help kids arrive, to quiet down their nervous systems and help the brain turn on and get learning ready.
So, you can see the chat box already. Let's go back to the point. Okay, so, yes. Fatima, yes, mindful body, feet are flat on the floor, give them a chance to make it all the way into the room with exactly Parina, with their bodies and their awareness. She tells us to listen, don't worry, Mari. She tells us to listen. What does she tell us to listen to? Apologies if somebody's already said it in the chat, I missed it. Yes, to listen to our breathing and recognize the fact that you are breathing. Exactly. So I chose these three sentences because these are practical things we can tell our students to do. We can tell them to come into the classroom with your mindful body. We can give them a chance. We can give them the opportunity to arrive 100%. So this teacher, in this video, there was this teacher who she's introduced her mindful moment. She called it a mindful minute, which she introduces at the beginning, 1 minute at the beginning of every lesson. So we watched a video. So going back to how can we introduce it? So we watched a video for teachers leading these mindful moments. And also we could then create a simple prompt or simpler belief. So as I just mentioned in this video that we saw, this teacher, she had her mindful moment, she called it her mindful minute. She uses the same script or same prompt she uses at the beginning of every class. And then motivate students. It's really important to motivate students. How can we get, so this is answering the question, how can we get students on board? Well, one way we could get them on board is why not work on an article in class? Pick an article which looks at the benefits of mindfulness. Share the scientific research with your students on how it specifically helps to calm the central nervous system and can actually be a really effective way and technique for them to deal with their emotions, with stress, with nervousness, and to improve their own focus, their concentration. And then last but not least, practice every day and reflect. So continue, it's important to continue it throughout the year. And why not encourage students as well? You can then encourage students to practice, when it becomes something that you instilled in your classes and your students are used to it, you can encourage them to then expand this and practice at home, maybe before they have to study, or when they're feeling a little bit maybe overwhelmed, then they can also expand and do this at home and share their experiences with their other classmates. So we looked at a simple way to include a mindful moment into the classroom. Let's now just focus on four main benefits. So incorporating a mindful moment in the classroom then also has four main benefits that are particularly interesting in education. So as you can see, for two of them, I've mixed up the words, and two of them, I've taken out the vowels, okay? So what's the first benefit? Number one, what's the first? Improved attention. Exactly, improved attention. So there are now numerous studies which have shown improved attention, including better performance on objective tasks that require a more extensive concentration span. Okay, so numerous studies have shown this. So number two, I've taken out the vowels for now. Number two, not quite mental. That's Hannah's already gone to number four. Okay, exactly, Sonia. Great, thanks. Number two, emotional regulation. So mindfulness is then associated with emotional regulation. Across, there's been a number of studies as well. It actually shown that it creates in the long term, it creates changes in the brain that means that there is less reactivity and a better ability for teenagers, for students to engage in tasks, even when they're aware and feeling these emotions. What about number three? Yes, Nunziata, exactly. Greater compassion. So also this research showed that people that have been randomly, teachers that have been randomly assigned to start practicing more mindfulness became more compassionate and were more likely to help and support and show greater passion, compassion to others. And of course, I've seen, as already, you've already put in the chat box, number four, reduction of stress and anxiety. So mindfulness reduces these feelings of stress. It improves this anxiety and distress when put in stressful situations. So for now, the rest of the webinar, we're gonna focus in on emotional regulation. We're going to focus in on here, and we're going to think about how can we help our learners become more aware of their emotions and other people's emotions and help them get into that right frame of mind. Remember, at the beginning, we were looking at those five ways that we can really help prepare our students for the exams, and the number four is getting them into that right frame of mind. So now we're going to have a look at some ways of how we can easily bring this into the classroom. So first of all, the idea of an emotional traffic light. We can use clear signals which allow us to keep track of how our classroom is feeling, and it also helps our learners become more aware of how they're feeling at a certain moment in the class. So maybe it could be before carrying out a task, or it could be after carrying out a specific exam task. So we can just stop and ask our students to show a green, yellow, or red card, and then we ask them, how are you feeling? And we ask them to show a green, yellow, or red card. And then we can maybe ask them, okay, can they be a little bit more precise? Can they use words? What words would they use to really describe this feeling with the card? And if your students need a little bit of help, a language help as well, you can also use this emotional thermometer. This is actually taken from the film Inside Out. If you haven't seen the film Inside Out, it's fantastic. I recommend that you watch it. So as you can see, in this thermometer, they also have the language support. So if they show up a green. Okay, yes, I'm feeling calm. I'm feeling relaxed, happy, sad, unhappy, or I've got a bit of a problem. And also you could even develop and maybe expand on the vocabulary there as well and have that in one corner of your classroom. Have that. So every so often, maybe after a task or before a task, you can use it to gauge this emotional thermometer with your students. So here also, why not ask them? You've asked how your students are feeling, but then you can ask them, oh, why don't you ask your learners? Maybe you already do ask your learners. Okay, so how do you think I'm feeling? And so how do you think I'm feeling, and see how your students respond. Here the idea is for your students to not only become aware of their own feelings, but also then to become more aware of others. What makes you, their teacher, feel happy, proud, relaxed? So remembering that the definition, part of the definition of mindfulness is noticing the world around you. So not only noticing your emotions, but also the effects and the emotions of people around you. So just by adding that question, getting your students then to think, okay, so how do you think me, your teacher's feeling? And now an even more focused activity. So this is kind of along the same lines. We've looked at an emotional thermometer, emotional traffic lights. Focusing in, we could pick these two adjectives. So why not pick these two adjectives, proud and disappointed? Yes, sorry, Vi, can I use smiley faces? Yes. Emoticons as well. You can adapt that to emoticons. You could ask your students to use emoticons to show how they are feeling as well. That's exactly the same thing. So focusing back on here, so you could focus on these two adjectives, yes, so proud or disappointed. Put two signs on opposite sides of the walls of your classroom. On one side, put proud. On the other side, disappointed. So after doing an exam task, ask your students, okay, so after you've done an exam start, say, okay, get up, and I want you to walk to one of the signs or near the signs, where ask them to go. And then you get to them to explain how they're feeling, give them some feedback. So if they move to disappointed, so why do you feel disappointed and proud? Why do you feel proud? But really important here, do this before you check the answers. This is the key, to do it before you check the answers. So getting the students to really focus on their performance rather than just the outcome. So again, we're thinking about how we can, these three easy techniques, and also one that you mentioned in there, Vi, you mentioned in the chat box using emoticons, getting them in that right frame of mind, helping them towards feeling more confident about themselves and towards working towards the exam. Visuals are another great resource. We have visuals which we can exploit in the classroom. So over to you, look at this visual on the screen. I'm going to ask you in the chat box, what do you see? Okay, what do you see? Children playing. Thank you, Cesar. Via a group of children. Melissa says people playing. Marina says energy. Cesar, volleyball. Ah, wonderful, freedom, having fun, teamwork. Okay, happiness. Okay, so what does it make now? Now you're actually, I think you're probably answering my next question. What does it make you think of? Well, actually my last question, so what do it make? Friends, joy, having a lot of fun, happiness, yes. And the third question, how does it make you feel? And I think you've already jumped ahead, exactly. Vacation, happy, friends, mindfulness, calm. So we could ask our learners, we could ask them, our learners to do this, for example, to do this individually. Wonderful. Thank you, Valeria. Makes you think of my family when they're having fun together, relaxing, energizing fun. So we could ask our students, for example, to do this first individually then ask them to share in groups. Then what could we ask our students to do next? Why not ask them, do any of the words you used describe how you feel about the exam you're getting ready to take? So you can transfer it. Fun, enjoyable. And I'm sure there must be, you know, the first thing that comes to our minds is that, well, we might be thinking that enjoyable and exams just don't go together. But remember, the aim here is helping our students to recognize and describe emotions. So you could do something like this, transfer it, ask them how does it make them feel about the exams. And yes, well, you never know. Maybe students will surprise you and say, yes, I'm excited about taking the exam. But the objective here is helping our students recognize and describe their emotions. So where did I get this visual from? So this is a photo, it's a visual from one of our exam preparation course books. This is from Compact. It's exam, explicit exam preparation. Yes, you can see it's about sports. It's looking at the language, looking at the vocabulary. You've got your exam preparation, but there is no reason why we can't use these visuals that we have in the materials that we're using to focus on emotional regulation and touch into the students' emotions at any time, as I just did here with you. How else can we exploit this with material? So here's another typical double page spread. We have another page from another exam preparation course. This is from Complete. So we'd say, yes, okay, focusing on reading and use of English part 7. Here the students have to match different questions to different texts or sections, and they have to read about 4 different holiday experiences. How can we now exploit this to bring in emotional regulation into the classroom? Well, if we just focus on the reading, just go into the focus on the reading, this is an excellent opportunity to use something called an empathy map. Okay, so here you can see on the screen, an empathy map. So using an empathy map is another great way to help teens to start thinking about other perspectives and other people's emotions. So we can ask our students, for example, here in this reading, there's 4 different people talking about their holiday experiences. So, for example, what you could do here is put your students in groups of 4. And so you have groups, one group that is only looking at Anna's experience, and they're using the empathy map. So what did she say? What did she think? What did she do? How did she feel? Then you have another group that's looking at C, D, and B. So they work together on that empathy map. Then once they've worked on that, you can then form new groups, and one person in each group from A, B, C, and D, and then they share their empathy maps together. So you're not only focusing on emotional regulation, but you are also developing their speaking skills, and of course, combining this with exams, as Georgia says in the chat. And I've got another idea here as well. So this is one. Here we've got another idea, which is called advice for a visitor. So we've looked at how we can exploit visuals, how we can use empathy maps. And empathy maps, you can use not only with reading texts, but you can also apply them to listenings. So they can listen and they have to apply the same thing, and also to videos. So you can videos, listenings, and texts. We can do this when we encounter a place in a course book. So it's in course books, we always encounter places. So in this here, in this example, this is from another course, Prepare, they encountered the place Moscow. But it could be, for example, a shopping center. So it could be a text around a shopping center, a city, as we've got here, a country, maybe a swimming pool. So when you encounter a place, in your course book, why not ask your students. So, okay, tell them they have to prepare some advice for a visitor to feel comfortable in the environment. Okay, so here, okay, you have to prepare advice for a visitor. They're coming, they're going to visit Moscow, they don't know it, and you have to help them feel comfortable. Elicit instructions from them and write all the instructions on the board from your whole class. Then you could ask them in pairs to decide. So once you've brainstormed all of the ideas from the whole class, then in pairs or small groups, depending how large your class is, they have to decide on the most important 3 or 4 instructions. And then they share their and discuss ideas with the class. So again, this is just another easy way to incorporate into the classroom and helping our students to focus and think about how they feel and how other people will feel as well. So then we've looked at 3 different ways how we can exploit texts and visuals in our materials. And finally, looking at building a positive learning environment, getting them, this could be done at the end of the week, at the end of a lesson, 3 good things that happened today. So it's not just writing down here. What's important is when we ask our students, okay, now we'd like you to write down 3 good things that happened to you today, or it could be this week or this month, you can adapt it as well, no? But the important thing here is not just writing the list of good things, but really focusing on the reasons why this went well. Why did this good thing happen today? And why did it go well? And thinking about the reasons is what requires much more genuine thought. So this is something that you can do and apply into your classes. This helps minimize students' anxiety, focusing all on the positive and the reasons for that, and it's reinforcing that, helps boost happiness. Just think, the moment you think about something that's good that's happened to you, automatically makes you feel good and automatically boosts your happiness and makes you smile, and gives learners that sense of achievement. Yeah, so I got a really good feedback from my teacher, and it's like, yes, I feel good. It's a great sense of achievement. It boosts happiness. So all of these ideas that I've shown how you can exploit with the materials that you might be using come from our Cambridge Life Competencies Framework. We've actually given some webinars in the past that look at the framework in more detail. And emotional development, as you can see here on the screen, emotional development is one of the 3 foundation layers of the Cambridge Life Competencies Framework. It underpins all of the other competencies. My colleague has just, thank you, Nadia, has just put it into the chat box. So you have this booklet here, which actually goes into more detail and gives you more ideas and techniques that you can introduce into the teenage classroom. And it actually follows, it goes all the way from primary all the way up to adult. And the other activities that I showed how you can adapt with material come from the life competencies cards. And here you've got them on the screen. And I do believe that my colleague will probably pop the link in for that for you into the chat box too. So you can see here a selection. This is just a selection of the activity cards. Hello, Lucilla, good morning. Of the activity cards that can also, you can use, and the techniques that are easily adaptable to material and to be able to incorporate it into your classroom. So just thinking, thank you, Nadia. So just thinking, tips for incorporating mindfulness that we've mentioned at the beginning of the webinar. Choosing a time for mindfulness, for mindful moments, be it for 1 minute at the beginning of every class. Getting the students involved. So at the beginning we thought, okay, getting them on our side, getting them involved could either mean, first of all, getting them on board, discussing about the topic in class with them based on a text or an article, the benefits, And then maybe, just an idea, then maybe if this becomes something that is part of your class with them and they're so used to it, then maybe you could even ask one of your students to start leading, and they could rotate, and they can each mindful moment lead a mindful moment with the rest of the class. Something to bear in mind. And then, of course, creating the environment. So maybe it could be making it making them aware that it's a special moment. If we look at the visual now on the screen, this teacher has a smaller class, so her mindful moment, she gets them all to pull their chairs in a circle. So that's how she creates this environment of that mindful moment in her classroom. And of course, as we mentioned, practice every day. So as soon as you start integrating mindfulness exercises into your classroom routine, even if just to begin for 1 minute, practice it every day, every lesson. Maybe you don't have classes already, every lesson, and then it will soon become part of your classroom culture. But I think it's also very, very important that we must remember ourselves. Teaching can be, I think, very stressful. Good teaching, I think, is very, very difficult. And we're all searching for the best tools, the best ways to be effective. All of you are here today watching this webinar, thinking, okay, are there any ideas, anything from this webinar that I can include into my classes to make my teaching more effective with my students? So it's so easy to get lost in having to help our students cover all the content to be ready for the exams. And if we just go into our classes and just ask our students to close their eyes and take deep breaths, then yes, maybe things will happen, but we have to be the person, we leading it have to be genuine. We have to have our own mindfulness practice. This will make us much more effective at leading those mindfulness moments, because we can only offer what we have developed ourselves. So how else could that include in our daily lives? Maybe a lot of you already do this, mindful breathing, eating, walking, including mindfulness into our everyday lives, just taking that moment to enjoy that fantastic, my favorite food, for example, that great crunchy apple. And last but not least, gratitude practice. And there's more and more research that just shows the benefits of gratitude on happiness and positiveness. You could start every day just asking, what am I grateful for? And how does gratitude make me feel? And I think that's something as well that we can include with our students, and a gratitude practice with our students. What are you grateful for? Write down three things that you're grateful for. And how does that make you feel? That, again, helping them get into right frame of mind. So, we're just coming now to the end. Some resources as well to share with you all, because I know there were some comments in the chat box. This is something from me that I got off Amazon. It's called Happiness Bootcamp. It's by an author called Jacob Glass, who's great. If you're interested, Google it. It really helps focus your mind in a positive direction at the beginning of a day. It's just a guidance on starting your day, gratitude practice, how you want to feel and how you want your day to go, and really bringing yourself into the present moment. And I've been using it, and it's great. Also, another resource I know, I think it was Vi who asked in the chat box, more videos, yes. And this link, my colleague Nadia, I think we'll put into the chat box. This website is Mindful Schools. You've got so many videos here. You have videos on what does a mindful school look like. For example, here on the screen, you can see 5 simple mindful movements for your classroom. Thank you, Nadia. I know that. And also, there's been a lot of research into mindful movement. So getting young teenagers to move as well. And this video here is fantastic. It shows different mindful movements that you can try in your classroom with your students. You've also got talks and teachers explaining how they began incorporating mindful moments and the positive effects it had in the performance of their students. With our World of Better Learning blog, we have this great blog here, Wellbeing and Academic Success with Christina. She talks about also the importance and different ways of how you can start incorporating this into your classrooms. Cultivating Teacher Wellbeing, Benefits of Curiosity and Compassion, another blog, which is a great blog to read, and looking at how you different ways and techniques to also start cultivating your own well-being. And this is actually linked to this book that we have, which focuses on, I've put here the table of contents so you can see it, actually first of all looks at understanding how our minds work, and then focusing on ways to begin cultivating, first of all, our own well-being as the teacher, bringing that into our schools from this and into the classrooms with our students. So it's a nice step-by-step process of starting with ourselves and bringing ending in the classroom with our students. And last but not least, from a very dear colleague of mine, Matthew Ellman, who has this blog, which looks at key to successful exam teaching as well, with some great tips to help support you in the exams. So, as you've seen in the webinar today, we touched about what is mindfulness. We looked at how it can help in exam preparation, getting our students into the right frame of mind, helping them develop these techniques, become more aware of their own feelings, their own now, how this affects others, and different ways we can incorporate into our classes. So mindfulness moments, but also little techniques that we can adapt using the material that we have to help our students develop also that emotional regulation. So thank you for listening to me. And I don't know whether now there's some questions, Nadia.
Thank you so much, Andrea. Amazing session. I hope you all enjoyed it. So if you've got any questions for our experts, please write them in the Q&A box. I saw some questions in the chat before, so we can discuss those. Also, there was one in the Q&A box that I found really interesting, and it was whether mindfulness is connected with psychology. I don't know if you want to say something about that, but I found 2 very interesting articles from the American Psychological Association and also from the British Psychological Society. I can put these links in the chat now, but if you want to say something, Andrea.
No, of course, it definitely is. They've done a lot of research. They've done research. Yes, so much. Psychology, they've done research into the benefits of mindfulness and movement. There was one, the importance of, they did research into one paper that I didn't read it in depth, but it looked at the use of karate.
Oh, yeah, interesting.
Because of the movements of karate. And using it with mind, combining those movements with mindfulness, and this actually it was an American university psychological department, and they actually showed the benefits for that this had on students.
It's absolutely fantastic. So you should really look into those 2 articles. So definitely there's a connection. There was another question in the chat whether, so when you spoke about Andrea, why not ask students to mention three good things that happened to them today? So they were asking, okay, should that be about something that happened in the classroom, about something related to the exam or anything?
I think it can be anything.
Yes.
I think it can be anything. When I say three good things, it can be anything.
Yes.
Because our students bring in, we don't know, they bring their worlds into our classroom.
Absolutely.
Sometimes we're not aware. So I think sometimes they need to focus on what is good in life outside of the classroom.
Yes.
So I would always say anything. Three good things that happened this week, which could be that, it could be, oh, my team won the football match.
Yeah, exactly.
I was laughing with my best friends over a really funny joke.
Exactly.
Anything, but I would say anything.
And that's really nice because it's also focusing, as you said, like on the small things. It doesn't have to be three huge achievements every day. It's really that focusing on good things can be small and still we can still appreciate them. Yeah.
And it's also helping develop that confidence in themselves. And especially at that age, a teenager, they're going through so many changes.
Yes.
I mean, we've all gone through this. We
do, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So the going through this is really important.
Yeah. And speaking actually of teenagers, maybe something, I don't know that some of you might be thinking, this is all nice, but what do I do with my teenage class? They're not going to take this seriously. They're going to laugh and giggle and not focus. How can we kind of approach this?
I think also depending on the size of you, if you have larger classes and that's more, we know that some teenagers will do that. I think the most important thing is to stay with it. I will just ignore them and keep going. It's like when we mentioned practice, do it every day. I mean, every day, every class, build it in, practice that you do, and then it becomes part of the classroom culture. And I think bit by bit, all of the students will be coming on board. And as you mentioned, another way to combat that as well is maybe begin, if you feel that you have students that won't take this seriously, begin with an article that looks at the benefits of mindfulness, looks at the scientific research. So we're informing, we're not just asking them to, just close your eyes, take deep breaths. No, we're explaining that there's a reason why we're doing this.
Definitely. Yes. Yeah. Really good point. So we can approach this from different angles. And I think definitely routine, super, super important. And also, as you mentioned already, Andrea, but I think it's such an important point. If you are really interested and you really believe this and you stand behind this, it will translate, as you know, as teachers in the classroom. Mm-hmm. If you bring in the enthusiasm, the students also kind of get this enthusiasm, so go in with that in mind. Absolutely.
Definitely. We have to believe in it. And I think also, like we said, have our own mindfulness practice. I think we all have our own techniques and ways of just, when you have that moment, I'm getting a bit stressed, let me just either we will have maybe go for a walk, that's a mindful moment. Sitting down, taking a deep breath. I think sharing that with our students as well, maybe I didn't mention that, but I think it's also important that maybe they can share that between each other if they start bringing those techniques and expanding it outside of the classroom, and also that you share with them.
Yes.
You know, when I get very stressed, this is what I do.
Mm-hmm. Yes, precisely. So Vi is asking kind of similarly, what if you have really shy students? How can we kind of incorporate mindfulness with them? I don't know if you've got any tips.
Well, I think if we're doing a mindfulness moment and we're just asking everybody to focus in, we're not focusing in on any of the students.
Yes.
They shouldn't feel picked out, or whether we're not asking them to produce or to perform or to do anything. Thank you, George. And they're not being exposed.
Yes.
That's the word. Fantastic.
they're not being exposed.
So I think and also I think it can be I wish I had this in my classes. I wish my teachers did it with me when I was a student. I think if we do it all together, then they shouldn't feel explosive. Exactly. They should feel safe and not.
Yeah, precisely. Yeah, completely agree. Maria asked before in the chat whether all of these techniques can be applied to our little ones, to our little young learners.
Oh, are you going to say or shall I say now?
You can say it, Audrey.
Okay, sorry, but I didn't know the teacher's name. Sorry, who was it?
Maria.
Maria, do not worry, because we've got the next two webinars. I think they're in May, if I'm mistaken.
Yes, 9th and 11th.
Exactly, we're going to focus on mindfulness in primary. So yes, we can definitely implement activities and techniques in the primary classroom, which we'll be looking at that in the next two webinars.
Exactly. Yes. So Maria, stay tuned. Have a look on our website, May 9th and 11th. We'll focus specifically on young learners. Fantastic. Good. Then another question from Mustafa. He's asking that his students kind of got afraid to study, and how can I change that? And I think, I guess, afraid to study, afraid of the exam, perhaps of the pressure. And I think in that case, mindfulness is actually a really great tool. So
definitely. I think if they're feeling afraid or nervous, then that's definitely getting, there's another technique called name it to tame it. Mm-hmm. So basically, if it's helping them recognize those feelings, so they name, I'm feeling nervous, I'm feeling frightened, okay, so they name it. And the moment that they recognize it and they accept it, then they can start dealing with it. Yeah, that's it, Maria, name it to tame it. So that's another, and I think that's very true for everybody. The moment you recognize and you think, okay, all right, I know you're there, I feel that feeling, it's normal.
Exactly.
We all, like we said in this webinar, emotions are a part of human life.
Yes.
I think maybe Mustafa, I don't know whether that is a help, but think about getting them to just name those feelings and being aware and identifying them, maybe writing down how it makes them feel. Okay, I feel like this, and then when they see it, they can deal with it and cope with it better.
Yes, so do have a look as well, Mustafa, in our cards, the life competency cards for emotional development. So there are things about recognizing emotion, expressing emotion. So that would be helpful in that case. Yeah, definitely.
Exactly. That's in there. Yes.
Yeah. And then because you highlighted also, of course, and a lot of you have mentioned this in the chat as well, it's so important for us teachers as well to do mindfulness practice, to be mindful. Do you have any tips or any app recommendations where someone could access?
No, I know there's so many apps now. I don't know. I just want to make a note, because I know that Jorge put, sorry, before that, I want to, Jorge, so how can candidates to be to exam reduce their fear of failing? I think what's really important, especially with the Cambridge exams, we're not looking what they're doing wrong. We're looking at what they can do. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But I think that's immediately changing frame of the mind frame. And also looking at maybe incorporating some of the activities that we mentioned today, and also linked to what Mustafa's question was as well.
Yes.
Focusing on that feeling, reducing that feeling, so naming that feeling. It's normal. We all feel nervous. I don't think that anybody, before I gave this webinar, I'm feeling nervous.
Yeah? Totally normal. Yeah.
Exactly. And I think talking about it, naming it immediately is a step forward towards them being able to develop these strategies to deal with it.
Yeah.
And regarding the apps, there's so many apps out today.
That's so many.
I used Insight Timer. I don't know if anybody knows. Insight Timer is a great app. You've got so many different music mindfulness activities that for there's even on Insight Timer, there are even mindfulness activities for teenagers and little kids as well. Ah, yeah, Jorge says insight timer, yeah.
Yeah.
Another one is, I know a friend of mine uses Headspace. I haven't used Headspace, but I think Headspace is also another app as well. Mm-hmm. And even if you go to another great website that I think is fantastic is edutopia.org. Mm-hmm. There it's actually a website, if you're not aware of it, it's a website that's set up by the George Lucas Foundation, the director of Star Wars. Oh. It's fantastic. And you've even got there lots of different mindfulness techniques that you can try out in your classroom. So there's lots and lots of different resources out there and ideas and help. And it's just, I think it's up to you to try what fits better in with exactly. who you are and how mm-hmm. you feel and how mm-hmm. you put that into your classroom.
Exactly. There are lots of options, definitely. Thank you for those recommendations. I do just want to talk about one last question because two questions came up about the speaking. Students are scared of the speaking test. They're so scared that they sometimes speak very quietly. What can you do essentially to help them? And I think all the things we talked about today definitely are super useful, especially right before the speaking as well. And I also want to say one thing, because I do work for exam support, and I don't know if you know our videos on YouTube, so we've got examples for speaking tests. We will get new examples, so stay tuned, middle of the year. Really go through these with your students to show them this is what the exam is like. The examiners are also just people who are maybe also even nervous. Mm-hmm. Show them the videos, go through it with them, and yes, practice the tips that Andrea has mentioned. I don't know if you want to add something to that.
And I think also listening and reading Vi's question, I think if they can also start at the year, and then when it becomes part of the, and your students understand it and they can see the benefits, yes. then maybe try and expand that they start using it outside of the classroom, yes. like yes. we mentioned, and then they can compare. So if they start developing these techniques and these skills of mm-hmm. learning how to ground themselves, yes. learning to focus on the breath,
yeah.
not fight the feeling. So it's yes. there, it's normal.
Yeah.
I'm just yep. going to ground myself and be able to manage mm-hmm. those feelings.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Fantastic. Thank you all so much for your great questions, for your great comments. Thank you, especially Andrea, for all your grades, you, for sharing your expertise with us. And you will be able to watch this recording again on YouTube from next week. You will get a link to the resources so you can look at all the blocks and life competency cards and the Mindful School website again. And you will also get a certificate. So someone's just asked, yes, you will get a certificate after the webinar. So hopefully that answers most of your questions. Thanks so much again to everyone joining us. And
thank you, everybody. Thank you.
Have a lovely rest of the day. Thank you, Andrea.
Bye.
Goodbye.
Bye-bye.